Let's all worship together, come on.
Joyful and triumphant, oh come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of Angels. Come and pray that you
we sing bring peace.
On earth.
trusting, believing. God, I need a miracle. I'm waiting, I'm watching. Nothing is impossible. I'm trusting, believing. I'm gonna see a miracle. Come and do what only you can. Come and do what only you can do. I'm counting on, I'm counting on you. I believe that you can see me. Can you do what only you can do? I'm counting on, on you. I'm counting on, counting on. I'm counting on, counting on. I'm counting on, counting on. On you. I'm counting on, come on, sing it out. I'm counting on, counting on. I'm counting on, counting on.
Experience the magic of Christmas at Central. Enjoy a holiday experience for the entire family, including free family fun, featured performances of classic Christmas carols, guest appearances by some of your favorite Christmas characters, and a message of hope. To find a location near you and for experience times, visit christmasatcentral.com.
My friend Holly to the stage this weekend, will you? I've had the privilege of knowing Holly over 22 years. In fact, she was one of the first people that we met, my wife and I, when we first moved to Vegas. And I fell in love with her heart for people and her heart for Jesus and the church all the way back then. And I know, Holly, you've got an incredible story even as a young girl. When you found faith and this whole idea of people in need became really real to you. Tell us about your part, that part of your story.
Well, I was raised in a little bit of a different environment. My parents are musicians, and so I spent a lot of time by myself as a kid because they would go to work at night and I would be home by myself. And that meant that they were sleeping during normal times. So they would send me to temple, but they wouldn't go. So they didn't know anybody. So we had no relationship. And the temple set up very different. It's like a membership kind of a thing. And I wasn't a member. And I didn't really know what was going on. And I felt so, just not like I was in the right place. Like I just didn't feel like I belonged and I didn't feel like I fit in. So I kind of just shied away from like religious stuff because I just didn't feel like I fit there and I didn't feel like I fit anywhere. And when I first came in contact with Christianity, it was so different. It was like this unconditional love, and it didn't matter what my background was or if I had any money or I came from a poor family or rich family. And actually, it was one of my very best friends that demonstrated that you could be normal and cool and fun and Christian all at the same time. And I don't know what I was thinking, but for some reason I didn't know that. And she modeled that for me. And in fact, she's actually here right now. And because of her, I have the best relationship I could ever have. And I'm so grateful that somebody didn't overlook me, because I literally told her, don't say Jesus around me because I can't relate at all. Just say God. And she was cool. She didn't argue. She just said, okay, whatever you want me to say. And she gave me a Bible and she made it fun and real, but it was still okay because it was still cool, which at the time I was, 20. That was very important. But, we didn't have much and we didn't grow up having much. In fact, I spent a lot of time on the unemployment line with my parents. And there was one time that comes to mind in particular that my dad was the best dad in the world. Like, he's just lost him in January, but the best father ever. And so he took me go-kart riding with the last of the money that we had. And he thought we were gonna get the check for the unemployment check that week. And it didn't come that day. And so we get home and he's arguing, my mom's mad at him, and I felt terrible. I think I'm like six. So I took my piggy bank, and it was like old school piggy bank where you have to break it to get the money out. And I took it to my mom. I'm like, here, here. Like that was gonna solve everything with my $1.69 or whatever I had in there. But I remember that feeling, and feeling like when I grow up, I'm never gonna live like this. this. Like, no matter what, this is not going to be my experience. So when I saw what we were doing, I'm like, oh my God, we have to do this. Like, how can you not get in there and help kids? Because you're six, you don't understand. You don't know why you don't have food, or you don't know why your parents can't do what the other parents can do. So for me, this is an awesome opportunity to fix it, because it's broken. You know, if you're a family, you know what it's like. If you're a mother and you can't provide for your kid, there's nothing worse. You'd rather go hungry yourself 1,000 times than have your kid miss one meal. So I wasn't going to get up here and cry at all. That was not my plan, but sorry. I don't even know what I'm supposed to be saying. What else do I need to
do? You could see Hallie's heart for kids and people, and part of it's from the brokenness of her own family. She lived that, and she said, I can't just ignore it. In fact, right when the pandemic first hit, Hallie was one of the first ones to call us up and say, I want to help. I want to be a part of this. From volunteering to giving financially, she's a very successful realtor here in Las Vegas. Maybe you've heard of Hallie's Angels. This is the Hallie of Hallie's Angels. And she's part of our family. And she has been on the front lines during this whole time. I can remember our very first Hope for Kids drive-through experience, and Hallie made a significant contribution. And I looked at her, I said, Hallie, this is so generous. And she looked at me and she goes, how could I not? How can I not help people who are hungry? And it was just like so natural for you to say that and just be like, I'm in. And you've stayed in ever since that time, and you've never wavered, you've never failed. What has it meant to you to be that person that's helped all these families?
I don't even think of it as being a person that helped. I feel like God's helping, and He gives it to us so we can give it to where it needs to go. You know, it's not me. I'm not doing anything, you know. I can tell you this, though. You go through stages in life. The first stage is survival. And, you know, you worry about the food on your own table. And then if you're lucky, you get to stability, where you've had enough food on your table for a while that you're not worried about it. And then if you're even more lucky, you get to success, where you have more than you need. But if you stop there, your life is empty. Because if you don't get to significance, where your life changed the lives of other people, you missed the whole thing. And there's nothing ever that feels the same to receive as when what you gave made a huge impact. So I would encourage you, if you've never done it, it doesn't have to be a big thing. Sometimes it's the smallest little thing. Sometimes it's paying for somebody's coffee, or helping somebody fill up their gas tank, or helping somebody with a tire that doesn't have the money to get it, or, you know, those little small things that are big things. But if you haven't experienced what it feels like to participate in a blessing, it will change the way you see things forever. Like, being blessed is awesome, but being a blessing is what life is about.
It's so good, Hallie. Well, you've been that so much to so many people. You're a blessing to the Central family. You're a blessing to the literally thousands of people that have been fed through our food pantries, and the thousands of kids that are going to be helped here in about 11 days through our drive-through Christmas experience. Thank you for being a part of this church, and thank you for loving people the way that
Absolutely.
You do.
It's my
we
honor,
celebrate
truly.
You so much,
thank
Hallie.
You. Thank you. Thank
yes.
you.
Give it up, big church.
Thank you.
Come on. It's just something rich in someone's life when you unlock that level of your life. Your life comes alive when you know that you can bless others. And that's why we encourage you to step into our Hope for Kids initiative. In fact, our team just informed me we're at 16,697 kids sponsored towards our 30,000 goal. Yes. And it's our dream to be able to sponsor all those kids, every single one of them. In fact, we got 2 more weeks before our first Christmas experience, and we're praying that over 20,000 kids will already be sponsored by the time we hit Christmas. We're 11 days away from our first drive-through experience, where literally hundreds and hundreds of kids will have a Christmas to remember, and no kid will go hungry. So we need you, church. We need you to step up now more than ever. And it's easy to get involved. You can go to central.family. You can go to centralchurch.online, or you can just simply find our generosity team member in the lobby. They're wearing red aprons. You can give by credit or debit card, or find an usher with a bucket. Give by check or cash. But thank you. Thank you for giving. Thank you for making a difference, and thank you for being there for others. Well, let's go to God in prayer. Will you join me? Well, Father, we're honored, humbled, in fact, to hear stories like Hallie's, that you've inspired her to be richly blessed, to be a blessing. God, that's what you desire for all of us when you give, that we are to give back to those that are in need, to those that need help. Father, those in the room right now that may need help, I pray that they would have the courage to let us know of their need. We want to meet their need. So, Father, give them that courage to let us know that. And for others of us that have been blessed, oh, Father, help us not to hang on to it, but help us to release it into your hands for your glory, for your honor, for your name's sake. And Jesus, I pray you'd lay it on our heart how we're to do that and to what level we're to do that. And Jesus, as we worship you, as we proclaim your name, I pray you fill this place with your presence. And may we experience you rich and deeply through our time of worship. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Joining us online, and you're just feeling like you need a miracle. Or maybe you're waiting on God for a miracle in your life right now. But oftentimes, when we look at God's miracles, when we look to the Bible, we see that His miracles are a response to our faith. And in the Bible, it says we can stand firm in faith. In God's word, it says your faith has healed you. It says we walk by faith and not by sight. It says if we have faith, even as small as a mustard seed, we can know that God will move mountains and He will work miracles in our lives. And one of the greatest ways that we can come to God and show Him our faithfulness is by going to Him in prayer, by surrendering what we might be going through, what we might be holding on to, by giving it to Him in prayer, by lifting others up in prayer. So if that's you today, and you're just willing to take that step of faith, maybe you're in need of prayer of any sort, whatever you're going through, it could be big, it could be small, I ask you to just raise your hand right now. Just reach out to God, say, stepping up in faith. If you're not raising your hand, I encourage you, just reach out to someone who is as we go to God in prayer today. God, thank you. Thank you that you are a God of miracles. God, thank you that we can step out in faith, that we can know that your mercies are made new every morning, God, that you've already won the battle that's before us. God, I lift up those who are reaching out to you today. Whatever's on their hearts, I pray that they would just be surrendering it to you this morning. God, we love you and we thank you. And it's in your Son's name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Let's continue to worship together today.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Amen. Amen. Wow, that was an incredible time of worship.
So
and I absolutely love worshiping with the Central Worship Team. That was awesome.
It's excellent. Every weekend.
Yes.
One of our favorite parts of the experience. Well, hey,
yes.
We want to give some shout outs to you right now. We've got Frank watching from Washington on our online location.
Yes.
We got Lorenzo watching from the Philippines, Brian from Louisiana, and Sunshine from Georgia. Thank you so much for being with us today. And also everyone at an in-person location, locations like our Henderson location in Henderson, Nevada. Thank you so much for being a part of the Central family as well.
Absolutely. And those who are watching with our partnership through the Pando app and through our partnership with God Behind Bars, thank you so much for joining us and for worshiping with us. Well, are y'all ready for the word? Yes, yes. Let us welcome our senior pastor, Pastor Judd Wilhite.
Good to see you guys today. Hope you're surviving December. Okay, we are in it. You know, the good news about this time of year, y'all, Christmas music is totally legal right now. Like nobody, how many of you are only like Thanksgiving to Christmas, sort of Christmas music people? You're like, this is the only time, right? How many of you say play it all year round? You're good with it. All right, so those of us that are play it all year round people, look, man, we can do anything we want right now. It's legal. It's legal, it's good. Except some Christmas music, have you noticed? Even if you love Christmas music, it can start to grate on you over time. And there are certain Christmas albums that become so incredibly popular that, you know, they just sort of run their course. And I'm thinking about one right now. In fact, there's a lot of memes about this one, so I'll just share some memes with you. I saw this one right before right before Halloween. It says, enjoy Halloween while you can. Mariah is defrosting as we speak. Then Thanksgiving came around. I saw this one at Thanksgiving. It says, November just chilling with Thanksgiving, and then the train smashes into the bus. All I want for Christmas is you. All I want for... Okay. This was my favorite. Mariah Carey's 94 hit, All I Want for Christmas Is You. Jack Nicholson from The Shining. And then look at this, retail workers in December. How many of you are retail workers? You're feeling that right now. Like, I cannot hear it one more time. Please do not play it one more time. Even if you love Christmas music, some certain Christmas music can start to wear you out this time of year. And it's kind of that way with everything, I think. Even if you love the holiday, there's a lot going on, right? Did anybody else like me have a little bit of an anxiety attack right after Thanksgiving when you looked at the calendar and you thought about all the things that you had to do over the next couple weeks? The shopping, some of you working the side hustle, trying to earn the extra money, trying to get everything pulled together, the travel, the arrangements, family coming in, all the stuff that goes with the holidays. We feel that pressure. And sometimes, you know, on top of all that, we've got just like the reality that if you live long enough, you will lose people that you love. And this time of year, you're mindful of the people that aren't with you as you go into the holidays, and you miss them, and it's heavy, and you carry it in your heart and in your life. And I don't know about you, but sometimes in December, I kind of feel like, look, all I want for Christmas is more than this. Right? More than the commercialism, more than the stress, more than the mile-long to-do list. And I think that desire for more is something God can actually use in our lives to point us to more, because we are made for more, and we're made for our relationship with Him, and we're made to walk in Him and to celebrate Him every day in our lives. And the truth is, even though we know that, we can lose that in the craziness of the holidays. I want to look with you at a different song today. Not Mariah Carey. An older song, actually one that's probably not as popular in more recent time. I want to look at the very first Christmas song. And you may or may not be aware of this, but Mary, the mother of Jesus, actually wrote a song. It's known as Mary's Song. And you find it in Luke chapter 1. It doesn't get talked about nearly as much these days. But Luke chapter 1, Mary gives us a roadmap to how we can get more out of the holiday season just by the song that she crafts and by the words of her heart. And so let me just bring this up on the screen. It's kind of how we do it at Central. I'll read this scripture, and when we get to the red word, I'm just going to ask you to say it real loud with me. It's how we make sure everybody's awake. But check this out. Luke chapter 1, verse 46. It says, Mary responded, "Oh, how my soul praises the Lord. How my spirit," what? Rejoices in my God, in my Savior, in God my Savior. And so Mary is in this vulnerable moment. She's about a few days since an angel came to her and told her she was going to have a child, even though she had not known a man. She's engaged to a guy named Joseph, but they're not yet married. The drama is high, the stakes are high, the uncertainty is high. And in the midst of all of that, what she does is she gives praise to God. That's her heart's response to all the uncertainty that has come into her life. And I want to suggest, if you want to get more out of the next couple weeks, then simply start your day with praise. Start your day, every day, the next few weeks, start your day with praise. Have you noticed it's so much easier to complain than to praise? Come on. I mean, it's just every parent can tell you this. You can do a million things right with your kids, but you do one thing wrong, they'll never forget it. I saw this on social media. I thought it was pretty funny. This person says, "Ask my 5-year-old what she wanted for dinner," and she said, "Not a burned quesadilla." Because in the summer of 2019, I overcooked one side of her quesadilla. How many of you are feeling that right now? You know what I'm talking about. Yes. All right, here's another one. Check this out. I forgot to pick my 5-year-old up at the bus stop one time. A year later, when I told him I loved him, he replied, "Yeah? Then how come you forgot to pick me up at the bus?" Left me out there hanging, right? All right, one more. One time we had to take money from our son's piggy bank to pay the babysitter in cash. Drove to the ATM first thing next morning to reimburse him. 10 years later, he still talks about that one time we stole all his money. Look, it is so much easier to complain in our lives. It's a natural thing. We complain about the weather, so cold, it's freezing outside. My gosh, you know. And then it's dark at like 3 p.m. It's just depressing, it's so dark, it's cold. And traffic, like, does every road in the city have to be under construction? Like, can we just have a minute where they just open everything up so we could just experience it once and then they can, you know, close off certain sections again? But at some point you're like, if we go this way around the city, if we go this way around the world, just go right through the middle, that'll take forever. You know, like, it's crazy, right? And it's so easy to complain. In fact, research shows that our brains are actually wired to remember negative experiences easier and quicker. They're more sticky than positive experiences. Research shows that if you lose a $100 bill, you will remember the experience of losing that $100 bill way more deeply than if you find a $100 bill and you try to think back to the joy of that experience. Right? We love to, look, complaining is natural. But I want to suggest today that praising is supernatural. And that if we will make an adjustment in our hearts these next few weeks, a slight adjustment, it can actually make a difference in the joy we have in our lives, in the perspective we have in our lives. And research shows people that are grateful and give thanks, people that live with an attitude more geared towards praise, will actually be more successful in their lives as well. And so Mary starts with praise. And look at what she says. Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 48. She's speaking to God. She says, for he took what? Notice. He took notice of his lowly servant girl. Now, that's interesting. That's Mary's perception of herself. Now, 2,000 years later, we know her as, you know, Mary, the incredible, you know, mother of Jesus. But Mary's like, look, I'm just a lowly servant girl. And he took notice of me. And from now on, all generations will call me blessed. He took notice of me. Turn to the person next to you and say, God notices you. God notices you. He notices you. And that is a word for somebody today. Look, God takes notice when you feel like you haven't done enough or earned enough. God takes notice when you feel like you've been overlooked or ignored at home or with friends or you know, at work. When you're quietly living your best life and nobody's coming along praising you or encouraging you for that. You're trying to make the right decisions and you feel like you're out there doing it alone. God takes notice, not just of Mary. God takes notice of you. God cares about you. God cares about his children, and you are not alone. He takes notice. In fact, that word, notice, that God takes notice, makes me think of the priestly blessing in the Old Testament. Priestly blessing that priests would pray over people. It goes like this. It says, may the Lord bless you and keep you. You may have heard this. Remember this? And may he make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. That phrase, the face to shine upon you, it's the idea of taking notice. God takes notice. He makes his face shine upon you. What does that phrase mean? Well, I think a great analogy to that phrase is to think of grandparents. When a grandparent sees their little grandbaby, and when a parent, to a certain degree, depending on how many nights of sleep they've had, sees that baby. But when a grandparent sees that baby, look, it's all joy, right? It's all joy and no responsibility for the grandparent, most of them. They see that baby doesn't do anything. It's slobbering, it's burping, it eats, it goes to the bathroom, it sleeps. That's about it, right? You know, like, and that little baby doesn't know anything. It sticks its foot in its mouth, its hand in its mouth. Anything it can get its hands on, it sticks in its mouth. But the grandparent doesn't care. Can you see their face? They're smiling, they're beaming. You know what's happening? Their face is shining upon them. right? They're loved, they're valued, not because of anything they could do, right? That grandparent's been waiting their whole life to be able to feed them whatever they want and send them back home. Come on. And I think that's the picture. God can make his face shine upon you. A look of delight and joy and satisfaction and a thrill at who you are because you are his child. You are his kid. And Mary says, look, I'm just a lowly servant girl. According to the world standards, I don't have money. I don't have degrees. I'm not from the big city. I don't have all the things going on. But God took notice of me. And God can take notice of you as well. And that is reason to praise. Think about this, like when God's face shines upon you, you have his favor and blessing working in your life. You have his protection holding back the chaos. You have his help to overcome. You have his peace. You have his forgiveness. You're on a mission living for something greater than yourself. You have this family of faith around you to encourage you. You have God's spirit within you to guide you and lead you. He takes delight in you, and that is why we can praise. We can be thankful even when it's hard. That's why even when we're not having the best day or the best season or the best holiday, we can give God praise because God is great. And when you lift your praise, God lifts your life. When you lift your praise, God lifts your life. So I don't know what kind of December you're having so far, but here's what I'm going to try to do in my life over the next few weeks. Start every day with praise. Before my feet hit the floor, as soon as my eyes open, God, I thank you for the gift of life. I thank you for the parts of my body that do still work. I thank you that I get to face the day. I thank you that I get to have food on the table. I thank you for my Cheerios. Come on. I thank you for the basic things. I thank you for the love and the family that I have in my life. I thank you that I get to go to work. I thank you that I have a job. I thank you that I get to serve other people today. Look, it's a perspective shift. And that shift can change a whole lot of other things in our lives when we engage in it. You want to get more out of this holiday than just stress, just all the commercialism, all the stuff? Start your day with praise. Here's another thought. Put your confidence in God. Put your confidence in God. So I don't know about how it goes in your family, but in our family, almost every December as our kids were growing up, there's always like more things that need to be assembled, especially like Christmas Eve night, if you know what I'm saying. Things that got to be put together. And so over the years, I want to be a good dad. You know, I try to put stuff together. I try to build it. I try to do the things. And I got to tell you, man, it always goes bad for me. I can build things, but it typically takes me 3 times as long as everybody else. And there's at least one total meltdown where Pastor Judd dies and leaves the room and the Hulk shows up. You know, at least something gets thrown. You know what I'm saying? Maybe some yelling. It's not pretty. But my wife, her dad's an engineer, you know, and her sweet dad, like, this is her dad happy, this is her dad sad, this is her dad excited, this is her dad not excited, and he could build anything. And so Lori got some of that from him, and she's amazing at putting things together. So I learned a long time ago, if I want to have any peace right before Christmas, I just give my wife the job of building all the stuff. And she loves it. She like put a show on and she's like, you know, I mean, there aren't parts left over when she's done it. Everything I try to build, y'all, I get it like 3/4 of the way there. And then I'm like, what the, you know, like it's, I got to disassemble. It always comes back to me having to disassemble something before the throwing begins. You know what I'm saying? Like, so Lori just, she's awesome at it, right? She builds it, it's calm, it's peaceful. So I have learned if I wanna have a good holiday, I gotta put my confidence in Lori and slide her the IKEA box. Say, that's on you. And I think the same is true spiritually. If I wanna have a good December, I have got to put my confidence, not in myself, not in my own abilities, not in the news, not in the finances in my life, not in all the external things, not in the state of my family or the state of my kids or the state of my grandkids, not in how my team is doing or not doing. I have got to put my confidence in something greater than all of that or I'll be disappointed. I have to put my confidence in God. I have to trust that He's going to take care of what I can't take care of. I have to trust that He's better at ruling the world than I am. Because who am I kidding? I can't even build the IKEA piece of furniture. One of the things Mary does in her song, she starts with praise. She acknowledges who God is. She praises God because He notices her and is mindful of her. And then as we go on, she begins to praise God and put her confidence in God because of both His character and His actions. In fact, check this out. Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 49, she says, "For the Mighty One is holy, and He has done what? Great things for me. He shows mercy from generation to all who fear Him. His mighty arm has done tremendous things." She puts her confidence in who God is. In fact, let me just sort of break it down on a slide here for you. First of all, she puts her confidence in God's character. Do you notice that? She calls Him three things. She says He's holy. Let's bring this up. He's holy, meaning He's separate. He's pure. He's above, right? This is the one characteristic of God that is like exalted three times in the Bible. Like the Bible, in the Bible, like in Isaiah, when the angels have this encounter, they sing to God that He's holy, holy, holy. In other words, He's not just holy. Not just holy, holy. He's holy, holy, holy. He's three times holy, right? And by the way, nowhere does the Bible does say God is love, but it never says God is love, love, love. Right? Anyway. But He's holy, 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 okay? So this is a tremendous characteristic of God. Then she says He's mighty. She's like, look, He's the Mighty One. He's done great things for me. He can move and He can work in my life. He's strong. He can handle it, even if I feel powerless. And Mary probably would have felt powerless about a lot of things in her life right then. I mean, she still wasn't sure how it was going to go down with Joseph. She's not sure how it's going to go down in her little village and how people are going to react to the fact that she's pregnant. But she knew not a man. And everybody's like, hello, I wasn't born yesterday. Like, there are issues going on, but she says, God's mighty, right? God's strong. God can handle it. But thank God, but if God was just holy and just mighty, that could be kind of a scary place to be because God could zap me like a bug. But He's also merciful. He's filled with mercy. In fact, in Exodus, God introduces Himself to Moses in His own words. It's the paradigm passage of the Old Testament. And God introduces Himself and He says, He passes before Moses and He says that He is the Lord, Yahweh, and He says He is compassionate and merciful. That's the first words God uses when He introduces Himself and His character in the Old Testament in His own words. He's merciful. He leads with that. He's merciful. And so Mary says, I can put my confidence in God because He's holy, He's pure, He's mighty, strong, He's merciful. And then she points to His actions. He's done great things for me. Put your hands together if God has done great things for you. Not just Mary, right? We can all look back and say, God has done some great things for me. And not only that, she says that He lifts up the humble. In other words, those that may not have it all together, those that need, those that realize that they can't run everything in their life, those that put their confidence in something greater than themselves, those are the ones God lifts up. And then she says He fills the hungry. In other words, He fills us not only physically, but spiritually. He provides for the needs of His people. And these are the reasons that we can put our confidence confidence in God. He's holy, he's mighty, he's merciful. He does great things. He lifts the humble, he fills the hungry. And so this holiday, you don't got to go through every day depending on your own strength and your own power. You don't got to face every moment depending on your ability to navigate the situation. You can push your confidence to God. You can trust who he is and what he's done. And what you put your confidence in will have everything to do with the way you experience peace in your life. You put your confidence in him, you'll have way more peace in your life. Here's a third thought from Mary's song, and that is to believe that God will do it again. Believe that God will do it again. Mary looks back. She closes her song out by looking back and acknowledging the promises of God. Check this out. Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 55, it says, "For he made this," what? "Promise to our ancestors." That was good. Thank you. "To Abraham and his children forever." She's saying, look, Christmas isn't just about this moment. Christmas isn't just about Christ coming into the world. This is the fulfillment of a promise that God made generations ago. This is God being true to his word. The Bible says in the fullness of time, Christ was born. And that in the original language, the idea of the fullness of time means exactly right on time, like the month, the day, the year, all of it. It was the fullness of time. The world was at the place that God predetermined the world needed to be before the Son of God came into the world. It didn't just randomly happen and God's like, well, we'll work with this. No, he planned it in the fullness of time when everything was right, when everything from the infrastructure of the world to the Roman roads and the travel system to the way messages were delivered to the way writing was happening, when all of that came together and God felt the time was right, in the fullness of time, Christ was born. And here's what Mary's saying. Look, God is in control. He's fulfilling his promise in Jesus Christ. He's moving and working. And if he's done it before, I believe he will do it now. And then that tells us he can do it again. Right? And so Jesus, before he ascends into heaven in the gospel, he says that he will be with us always, even to the end of the age. And look, he was not only born and taught and lived and died and rose again according to our faith, but he also ascended to heaven and promised that he would come back and that he is with us even now, which means no matter what I'm facing, no matter how stressful or hard or difficult right now, I believe that God is big enough to handle it. And he did it before. He was faithful to his word and his promise, and I believe he will be faithful to his word and his promise again. He's done it before. He'll do it again. He's not going to abandon you or turn his back on you or leave you out in the cold. He's not going to blow you off, kind of hang you out to dry. He'll be faithful. He's provided for you in the past, and he will provide for you again in the future. He comforted you in the past. He will comfort you again in the future. He's forgiven you in the past. He will forgive you again in the future. He's given you strength in the past. Listen, he'll do it again. He's given you peace in the past. He'll do it again. He's given you hope in the past. He'll do it again. He's seen you through every struggle. Come on, somebody. He's seen you through every battle. He saw you through all the dark nights. He saw you through all the pain and the difficulty. He saw you when nobody else saw. He noticed you when nobody else noticed. He walked with you when everybody else turned their back. He lifted you when nobody else was available. He rescued you when you weren't sure where else to turn. And he put your feet on solid ground. Listen, he's done it before, and that tells you he'll do it again. He'll do it again. So Christmas reminds us God's faithful to his promise. So this week, if you hear a little Mariah Carey coming on over the intercom at the grocery store, let it remind you God is faithful to his promise. This week, you get stuck in traffic and you're angry and you're frustrated, just let it remind you, God is faithful to his promise. And his promise wasn't just that Christ would be born. His promise was that Christ would return. His promise was that Christ would be present with us even today. And that no challenge we face, we have to face alone. So, start your week every day with praise. Shift your confidence and put it in Him. Believe that God will do it again. And you're singing a new song now, Mary's song, a song of praise and confidence in God and a song of acknowledgement that He's worked in the past. He'll be faithful to His promise in the future. And I think if we'll do that over the next couple weeks, we'll look back and we'll say, you know, I got a lot more out of this time because of those simple adjustments and the changes I made in my life. Maybe you're here today. Maybe you've never crossed that line of faith. I'd love to give you an opportunity just to reach out to God and to trust Him. I'd love to lead you in a simple prayer. You could say it out loud or just in your own heart and mind. It's really not the final spiritual step. It's more like a first step to open your heart to God. But if I can help you take that step, I'd be honored to do it. So I want to ask all of you to bow your heads and close your eyes. If you'd like to become a follower of Jesus today, you can begin that journey by repeating this prayer after me. Just say, Dear God, I thank You for loving me. Thank You for sending Jesus into the world. I believe He died on the cross for my sins. I believe He rose again. Forgive me for my sins. Give me the gift of eternal life. Help me face the challenges that I'm up against. God, I surrender my life to You in Christ's name. Friends, with every head bowed and every eye closed, if it's your prayer today, if it's your commitment, I'm going to ask you to just slip your hand in the air. Just make eye contact with me just to say before God and to say to me, you're going to follow Him in your life today. God bless you guys. Thank you. Thank you. Just reach out to Him. Thank you, guys. Hands going up around the room. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Just reach out to Him today. God, we love You. I thank You for each person just reaching out to You, and I pray You'll work and move in their life. Fill them with joy and purpose and peace, Your Spirit, Your power, Your forgiveness. God, we thank You for Jesus and all that He's done for all of us. We give You praise in Christ's name. Amen. Well, let's put our hands together for those who made spiritual commitments in their life. And I'm going to ask you to stand together with me, if you would, please. If you made a spiritual commitment, I want to tell you congratulations. We'd love to see you after service out in the lobby. Just go to our Next Step area. We'd love to give you a journal called the Follow Him Journal. You can also go to central.family and click the link, I've decided to follow Jesus. We can get that to you electronically as well. Just help you on your next spiritual steps in your life. Well, let's put our hands together now for Pastor Bob, who's got a few final thoughts for us.
Well, what an incredible message. Wasn't that a good message? Thank you so much, Pastor Judd, for that message of hope. And if you made that decision to follow Jesus, I want you to go to central.family, click on the button that says, I decided to follow Jesus. And we're going to send you those resources to help you along in your journey. Don't forget, family, we also have Hope for Kids. So if you want to donate and sponsor a child, you can definitely do that. Go to central.family. All of that information is on there. But in the meantime, family, I want you to hang on to Romans 8 that says, if God is for us, who can be against us? Keep showing up.